The Ramban, the great Nachmanides, on his commentary on the book of Bereshit, Genesis, he opened the door for us in this very deep and beautiful explanation, the concept of transmigration of souls. The Torah tells us in the book of Bereshit, it's a well-known story of Yehuda, the son of Leah and Yaakov, and the story of his three sons, Er, Onan, and Shelah. So what we're going to cover today is the strong correlation between the transmigration of souls. In the earlier time, the transmigration of souls to the Book of Ruth that we are focusing in today. First and foremost, the introduction of transmigration of souls was not by Nachmanides, but he is the one who opened the door and explained to us that the whole concept, the story of Yehuda and his relation to with his daughter-in-law Tamar has to do with Sod HaIbur, which is the secret of the transmigration of souls. What did the Nachmanides mean? Nachmanides was a great Kabbalist. Day before yesterday, David can witness to that, we are just finishing the study of Yomi in the Talmud, the tractate Kinim. It's a tractate that dealing with birds and different type of offering of bird in the ancient temple. And sure enough, we're about to finish the tractate. I walk in the chapel and I saw something I never seen for 10 years. It was a bird, beautiful bird. David get a little scared. And I said to him, don't worry, it may be a tikkun, it may be a soul that transmigrated. And since we are finishing the tractate Kinim, which is the Talmudic tractate dealing with the different dove and birds offering, it may be a soul that came here. The fascinating fact is that he or she, let's say she, find a way out when we are done with our talk, and then disappear. So is that really a soul? I don't know, but what I try to share with you today, there is a serious concept in Judaism that there are souls that coming back. So what we try to show today is from the Torah text itself, the beauty of the changing words in different locations or taking the context within the context, but in different location, you see this strong correlation between past, present, and future. So Nachmanides tells us that those relation that appear illicit relation between Yehuda, Judah, and his daughter-in-law Tamar, in a way it's meant to be. It shouldn't happen in the first place, at least it's appeared, because this is a father-in-law. But the result of the two sons, Peretz and Zerah, in a way it's meant to be. Now you ask, what do you mean by saying it's meant to be? Let's travel together, some point in the book of Bereshit, see the stories that I'm sure you're aware of, the story of several stories in Bereshit, and soon you see how everything is connected to each other. But before we go to Bereshit stories, since we study Ruth, and the goal is to understand deeply the Ruth, there is one line that should be our point of departure, and it's the Perek Gimel, chapter 3. And the text said something very interesting. They said, when Boaz met Ruth in the middle of the night, Boaz said to her, "Ve'ata biti al tiri." Now, my daughter, don't worry. whatever you wish to, whatever you wish will happen. Because it's known that you are a woman of valor. Ve'ata, now. Ki omnam, ki goel anochi, you ask me, meaning Ruth, you are asking Boaz to redeem your soul, and I am, in a way, your redeemer. It is true, but wait a second. Ve'gam yesh goel karov mimen. There is someone else who are closest kin to you, and that person take precedent before me, which is, you are right, there is a concept of redemption, concept of Geulah, but before you approaching me, since you considering me, Boaz, as a relative of your late husband, remember we discussed when the Torah tells us that it's an obligation in the Levirate marriage, the Book of Deuteronomy tells us that when a man died childless, like the story of Mahlon, therefore it's an obligation upon his brother, and in that case, the closest relative, to redeem the soul. Not only as an act of kindness, but it's also an act of perpetuation of the spark of the soul of the deceased. So in that sense, it was a wonderful idea of Naomi and Ruth to have Boaz, the leader of the Jewish community, redeem Ruth. However, Boaz, soon you see as an act of kindness, he didn't want to jump into that. He said, there are other opportunities. There is someone before me. Now, if you look at the Megillah carefully, you see that there is a one word that's missing. And that's something that's fascinating. We should take note of that. Because the word im, ki im goel anochi, so they said k'tiv v'lo k'tiv, which means, you say it, but you don't read it. The same, by the way, what we said earlier, when Naomi asked Ruth to go and speak to Boaz, she said, whatever you tell me, I'll do. But the word Eli is the opposite. It's kri, they said, whatever you tell me, I'll do. Kol asher tomri Eli, eh. But if you look at the Megillah, it's missing. The word Eli is missing. Why? Why is it missing? We'll discover that later, but it's part of this mystical journey. So he said to her, Boaz said to Ruth, Lini halayta, sleep over, stay overnight. And the word lamed is a long one, you know, like the Nachman of Breslov used to say, that it's going from heaven to earth, that's the expression of lamed. Stay here tonight, the hayala boker, and let's see what's happening in the morning. If either someone by the name Tov will redeem you, which is the closest relative, fine. So there's one option to say that Tov is a name. Later we say that maybe it's just expression, the real name is Ploni Almoni or unknown name. But anyway, he said, if you will be redeemed or Tov will redeem you, fine. The lawyer was the Galech, the closest relative of you. To redeem you, I'll be the one who do that. Chai Hashem is the act of oath, act of making a vow. Shichbi alavoka, lie here until the morning. And then, vatishkav margelotav. So the pasuk, the sentence is, so she lay at his feet. Ad haboker, until the morning, and then in the morning, she left. Now, soon we're going to examine the sentences here, but we leave this text for a second and we want to go to the background of this story, so later we come back to the text and we understand it better. The question that we presented here are, one, why is the Ruth motivation? Is just to have a husband or to have a redeemer or to fulfill Naomi wishes? Why Boaz? Willing to do it or give the option to someone else first? But most importantly, what exactly Nachmanides said for all this story has to do with the Soda Ibur, with the secret of transmigration of soul. So in order to understand that, we need to go to the original spark of the souls of these people. So let's start with Ruth. She, as we show in the past, in different chart, originally speaking, she came from the house of Lot. So in chapter 19, in the book of Bereshit, the book of Genesis, the Torah relate to us the story of Abraham and his nephew Lot. They are together, in a sense, they are in a business together. Then they grew and they became numerous. And then Abraham recognized his servant, etc. There are issues. Issues with honesty, issues with conducting proper business, or they expanded in such a level. So Abraham said to Lot, why we need to have such a constant friction between our entities? You can depart into whatever you wish to, and I'll go the other way around. And as a result, Lot chooses to go and depart from Abraham, and the place that he chooses was Sodom and Gomorrah, which again, the rabbis had a lot to say what it's all about, because in one hand he came from the house of kindness, and he came from the house of Abraham and Sarah, which is the epitome of chesed, of kindness, yet he chooses to go the other way around to the worst place, anti-kindness, which is Sodom and Gomorrah. So it appears like absolutely two opposites. Instead of going in the path that Abraham helped him and trained him and raised him, to go the other way around. But with that in mind, he went to Sodom and Gomorrah. He represented kindness in some way, but it was in the wrong conception. What does that mean? I'm not going to read every word, I'm just showing with you the concept. In chapter 19, the Torah tells us when the angels, the Malachim, came to Sodom and Gomorrah, Lot was sitting there, and he grieved them, and he asked them to come to his house, which again, you ask yourself, what is all about, he living in Sodom and Gomorrah? How Lot behaved in such a way? And the answer is, it's from the house of Abraham and Sarah. He came from such a background that he tried to help. Here are our guests. He saw in Abraham's house how they treated guests. So he tried to help them, and he asked them to come to his house, and he tried to protect them. But again, his influence on the society of Sodom and Gomorrah was so twisted that instead of being in the proper path of kindness of the way of the Torah, he offered his daughter, which to us sounds absolutely ridiculous. When these people get around the house and try to force relation on the guests, Lot went out and he said, don't do that to my guests, here are my daughters, they can substitute for the guests. And you ask yourself, what is one has to do with the other? So the simple explanation is, he has this beautiful trait, but he doesn't have it set up in the right, in our language, in the right file on the computer. It was a wrong. But then, because of Abraham, he was saved. And he went out. And now listen carefully to the text in the Torah, and you see the connection to the book of Ruth. As we said earlier, the descendants of Lot is Ruth. The descendants of Abraham is Boaz. So what happened? So they left, and they forced him out, and they went to the cave. Now, the language is as follows. Chapter 19, sentence 30. Vaya'al Lot mitzoah. Lot left the place called Zoah. Vayeshev b'har, and he dwelt in the mountain. Ushteit natav imo, he and his two daughters, his wife turned to be a pillar of salt. And again, the text said in that sense that vayeshev, and he dwelt b'me'ara. He dwelt in a cave. Ushteit natav, he dwelt with his two daughters. Now what happened here? Those who justify the event, which is an illicit relation between Lot and his daughters, they hold that the world disappeared, there is no future, so they gave their father's wine, architect said, and they have a relation with the father, illicit relation with the father. The first night and then the second night, most of the commentators agree that the first one, at least the first one, Lot was not aware, but it was all illicit relation between father and his daughter. Now what happened to that situation, that intercourse between father and daughter? So they said here, Vatharena shtebnut ma'avihem. The text said that basically v'lo yada v'shechorav l'kumah, that Lot is not aware of this type he was drawn. So as a result, these two daughters of Lot have two babies. Now, Vatelet abchira ben, the first daughter have a baby boy, Vatikra shmo Moab. She called the baby name Moab. And who is the Moab? Uavim Moab alayom. This is the forefather of Moabites. And you remember we discussed in the past that is a prohibition, the strongest prohibition in Torah that prohibited us from marrying to whom? Is to Moabite and Ammonite, which is the two sons that came out of the illicit relation between Lot and his daughter. One is called Moab, and the second one is called Bnei Amon, Avi Bnei Amon, Ben Ami, which is the Amon, the Ammonite. These two forefathers were born out of the illicit relation between Lot and his two daughters. So, what exactly happened here? It was the daughters that had relation with the father, and they named the child, in that sense, after the father. For example, Moab, Moab meaning from the father. It was illicit relation from the father, with the father. Ben Ami, son of the people, again, in a connotation, it's a son that came out of illicit relation. But that problem with that source that born out of the prohibited relations did not stay there. You see that the trait, and hold your mind with me because it's a little deep, okay? The whole idea of lack of kindness that demonstrated of Lot by leaving Abraham and going to the worst place, anti-kindness, which is Sodom and Gomorrah, expresses again, the Torah called the illicit relation chesed, which is prohibited. Chesed can go both ways. Chesed can be kindness, and chesed asu in the Torah, it also can go the other way around. So they have this relation, and as a result, later on, the Torah tells us that even Adamite or Egyptians, we can marry them in the third generation. When it's come to Ammonite and Moabite, even in the 10th generation, we are forbidden. And the Torah tells us specifically for two reasons that they had a lack of kindness. What is it? One, when we left Egypt as a slave, they did not bring up, not give us bread and water. The second reason, the Torah said, it's because they hired Bilam to curse us. All of that is an act of absolutely anti-kindness. Now, again, bear in mind, this is a man that was in Abraham's house, Lot. This is a moving out and going to Sodom and Gomorrah, then having illicit relation with his daughter. Then there are two sons that came out of that. And these are the forefather of that two nations that refused to give bread and water to our people when we left Egypt and hired someone to curse us. So the Torah put a very strong prohibition against marrying a Ammonite and Moabite male, because the Torah used the word Ammoni Moabi. It's all reflection to the male Ammonite and male Moabite. So, with that in mind, now we start getting the point of tikkun. When we're speaking about repairing the world, fixing mistakes that happened in the past, not carrying languages from the past, and we discussed the other day that It's like you go now on the airlines and they charge you for luggages and it's cost money. So the same way, the person who carried luggages from the past, you can do that, but it's cost you a heavy price. So in that sense, we try not to carry luggages, but there are certain things that the Torah tells us clearly from the past that it's unerasable, which is if it's a problem with the core, very, very basic issue, which is the planting of the seed of the nation, that needs to have a full tikkun, full process of repair. And that's the key reason why we have this Ruth story. The key reason is the spark of the souls, the rabbi said, the transmigration of the soul of Ruth came to repair those mistakes, to repair mistakes of lack of kindness. Ruth easily, we said many times in the previous chapters, in the study, the narrative, very, very easy way. Ruth was a daughter of a king, she was well off. Financially, she can go back and set up back with the Eglon's house, the king of Moab. She have all the goodies, she have no reason to help Naomi or to follow her, or at the top of that, try to merge, try to be part of a new nation. But because she have one mission, and the mission of her soul is a tikkun, is a repairing, that go back many, many generations earlier, the mistakes that was made with Lot and his daughter, now it's a time to repair those mistakes. In that sense, Naomi had the sense and the feeling that we are here not by coincidence. This whole story of this young lady, Ruth, leaving the grave of her husband, the family, and go to an unknown place with no future, it has to have a reason behind that, why she's here, and this is something to do with the future. And in that sense, she had the sense of prophecy, Naomi. But furthermore, we just mentioned earlier the text, and we said that when Ruth appeared to Boaz, when she came to him, the text said that she gets to the certain place that they use the word Arema, which is when she came to him. Let's read it, it's in the book of Ruth, chapter 3. So they said she came, Vayochal Boaz Vayesh, sentence 7, Vayitav libo, he married his heart, Vayavo lishkar, and he lay down, Bikce ha'arema. He lay down where? By the place that is the end of the grain pile, Arema, the grain pile, that's the place that he was. So then she came, Vatavo balat, and she came silently, stealthily, Vatagal margelotav, and she uncovered his feet and lay down, Vatishka. So now the rabbis tells us, the Kabbalistic rabbi, right? The great students of the Ari and others, they said that if you look at the text and you use the word Areima, Ein, Reish, Mem, Hei, which is in Hebrew meaning the grain pile, and you turn around the words, it's the word, the Hebrew word Me'ara, Mem, Ein, Reish, Hei, same Hebrew letters. Me'ara, you remember the Me'ara? The Me'ara was a place that Lot is a cave, that Lot and his daughter have the illicit relation. Not just that, the same text, the same pasuk said, Vatavo balat, bet lamed tet. And balat, she came, simply speaking, literally speaking, balat, meaning she came quietly. But in this way of interpretation, balat meaning the daughter of Lot. The same Hebrew letters, they use the text in the same pasuk. So here you see what's happening. This daughter of Lot, meaning descendants of Lot, she came back the same way at night to where it was in a cave, it was in a Me'ara, it is in a Aremana, the same Hebrew letters, just changing the order. So she is the daughter of Lot, come back to the cave, in a sense, come back to the place that it was a relation, but here is the passing the test, passing the trial. Nothing happened that night between them, but she is there on a mission, and that's the key reason why she used the word redeemer, ki goelata, you are redeemer. Furthermore, You see how beautiful we understand the further the text further on. They said, he said to her, Lini halayla, you should sleep here at night. So the rabbi said that there's a two dimension here. One dimension, Lili halayla, meaning sleep here at night. Others say that it can go that the same way that things happen at night to your ancestors by the illicit relation between Boaz, between Lot and his daughter. Now turn around and we wait until we formalize everything in the most respected way and proper way. Another dimension, Lini halayla, darkness in the writings expresses exile. Which is, this is expression of the Jewish exile, because remember, she is the ancestor of the kingdom of David. So, Lini halayla, sleep at night, but Lamed, the long Lamed, is expression, as we said earlier, like what Nachman explained, that is between heaven and earth. So, be patient at night, be patient with this great exile, Vehaya b'boker, which is in the morning, it's always an expression of the light at the end of the tunnel. Change in the morning. Things change for good. And he said, "In yigalech to yigal." If the redemption of the Jewish people happened naturally, which is people make the shuvah and people turn around and they have their emunah, they have their faith, fine. Tov yigal. If it happens in a natural, in a tov way, that's good. V'im lo yachpotz yigalech. But if it doesn't happen in a proper and a natural way, ugalechatich anochi. What is anochi? Anochi is the first one of the Ten Commandments. I am your Lord, your God. And that's the reason we said, Chai Hashem, we take an oath in the name of the Lord, the Lord of God. He says, Anochi, I am the Lord, your God, who promised us that we'll be out of exile, out of Egypt, out of the four different exile. So, Shichvi alabokeh, awake in the morning, and things will turn around for better. So now you see the strong correlation between the past and the present and the future. The strong correlation between the story of Lot and his daughter and how the whole history of the Jewish people and the destiny of Jewish people took place as a result of all the changes between the past and the present and the future. Furthermore, we now grasping the Nachmanides, the Ramban point of view, who hold so beautifully, and he said the Soda Ibu, the secret of the transmigration of souls, in conjunction with that special segment in the Torah, with the Yehuda or Judah relation with his daughter, again, it looks, appear like a recent relation. Yehuda had three sons, Er, married Tamar, and he passed with no children, Onan, was cruel. The Torah used the word Vayeda Onan nu. Ladat in Hebrew is basically either relation or knowledge. Kilo lo yazara. He knew that the descendants would not come toward him. In other words, the perpetuation of the soul as a result of Levirate Mary will be a continuation of the soul of his brother Er, and therefore he has no motivation. He was cruel to Tamar, and Vayera b'enei Hashem asher asa, God despise this type of behavior, that he lost his, he didn't use his potential of having children properly. So God took him as well. Now Yehuda left only with one son, which is Sheilah. So in a sense, you know, you said he was afraid of her. He didn't know what's happening. He saw that just he lost two sons with her. Or because Sheila was young, but anyway, she pretended to be an harlot, and the whole story, how in one hand he was righteous by admitting that this is my children, this is my babies. On the other hand, the whole story of some type of improper relation between father and daughter-in-law, Yehuda and Tamar. Yet you see the result of this, these twin sons, the Peretz and Zerach. And who is the parents? If you read the end of the Megillah, this is the forefather of King David. He's the forefather of Boaz, who is the forefather of King David and the husband of Ruth. So you see, my friends, the very strong correlation between mistakes that happened in the past and the opportunity that we have in our teaching, in our belief, The tikkun olam, the tikkun, apply the person can repair the world, the broken world that involved in the past. Furthermore, the great Arizal, the 16th century Kabbalistic, explained to us that the whole concept of the broken vessels, which is the way that the God created the world and he blew in nostrils the soul of life, it means that God basically contracted himself, tzimtzem, contracted himself in such a vessel, because we, meaning the world, cannot contain the great light of God. It's like sitting in a room with super electricity, we cannot survive. So it's basically explosion. If God, in a sense, in our language, anthropomorphic language, human language, did not basically contract himself to the small vessels that this is the light that we use in our lives. But those broken vessels is a mission that involves each and every one of us to repair the world individually and collectively. That's the key point, the repair of the world, the mistakes that happened with the forefather, with Lot, never ended by itself. The house of Abraham that came from kindness, returned to kindness eventually, took a lot of challenges, a lot of years, but it returned. So what we understand, the whole words of Me'ara and Arema connected, the whole idea of mistakes that made with Lot, lack of kindness, Sodom and Gomorrah, illicit relation with his daughter, repair, the problem with the relation with Yehuda and his daughter-in-law, repair, the whole Levirate marriage, repair, the same idea that Levirate marriage did not take place properly in Yehuda and his daughter-in-law, by avoiding the proper marriage between Shelah, Yehuda's son, and Tamar, that repair by act, voluntarily act, of Levirate marriage, of righteousness of Boaz. Boaz basically had the opportunity to reject that, but he instead made a out of a great arduous effort to repair it properly. And that you see in the text coming out so beautifully. And now we understand how we put all the pieces together. Number one, Boaz was a man of his 80s. He said, don't worry. He said to her that there is a future. And the rabbis tell us that the future applies individually and collectively, the future of the Jewish people. But furthermore, we see the whole story of the Jewish suffering and the exile and the suffering the people go through individually and collectively, at least the way that the Ramban understand, many other Kabbalistic rabbis, it connected very much to Soda Ibur, which is mistakes that happened in the past can be a past life, can be a descendant of some mistakes, can be a specific repair that the person had for certain act. But the prayer that we always said that we have the merit to do it and to do it properly and to fulfill our destiny individually and collectively the way that it should be, and may Hashem will help us to continue doing what we have to do in order to repair the world. And especially nowadays, where we see not only the gathering of our people and building the Beit HaMikdash, but also the time of the Mashiach era, the time that we believe the descendants of David will come and help the whole world. V'haya Hashem l'melech al kol ha'aretz, v'yom ahu, in that day, the whole world recognized Hashem echad and Ushmo echad. Thank you very much.